Saint Philip Neri, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, lives and reigns with you, the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Read from the Acts of the Apostles. From Miletus, Paul had the presbyters of the church at Ephesus summoned. When they came to him, he addressed them. You know how I lived among you the whole time from the day I first came to the province of Asia. I served the Lord with all humility and with the tears and trials that came to me because of the plots of the Jews. And I did not at all shrink from telling you what was for your benefit, or for teaching you in public or in your homes. I earnestly bore witness for both Greeks and Jews, to repentance before God and to faith in our Lord Jesus. But now, compelled by the Spirit, I am going to Jerusalem. What will happen to me there, I do not know, except that in one city after another, the Holy Spirit has been warning me that imprisonment and hardships await me. Yet I consider life of no importance to me, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus to bear witness to the gospel of God's grace. But now I know that none of you to whom I preach the kingdom during my travels will ever see my face again. So I solemnly declare to you this day that I am not responsible for the blood of any of you, for I did not shrink from proclaiming to you the entire plan of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks.
Sing to God. Restored the land when it languished, your flock settled in it. In your goodness, O God, you provided for the needy. Sing to God, the nations of the earth. Blessed day by day be the Lord, who bears our burdens, God, who is our salvation. God is a saving God for us. The Lord, my Lord, controls the passageways of death.
Jesus raised his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Give glory to your Son, so that your Son may glorify you, just as you gave authority over all people, so that your Son may give eternal life to all you gave him. Now this is eternal life, that they should know you, the only true God, and the one who sent you, Jesus Christ. I glorified you on earth by accomplishing the work that you gave me to do. Now glorify me, Father, with you, with the glory that I had with you before. understood that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for the ones you have given me, because they are yours, and everything of mine is yours, and everything of yours is mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I will no longer be in the world, but they are in the world, while I am coming to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
You remember when your Blessed Mother presented the child Jesus at the temple. Simeon the prophet spoke about Jesus. He says that he would be a sign that will be contradicted. A sign of contradiction. What does he mean? Means that Jesus' way, his teaching, would not conform to the standard of this world. The world hates the truth. And Jesus is the truth. And he will proclaim the truth. He will live the truth. He will stand up for the truth. And ultimately die for the truth. The world hates humility. She sees humility as a sign of weakness. And for Jesus, humility is power. It's the virtue you need to conquer the world. And as a humble lamb, it crushed the head of the beast of pride of this world through humility. And one teacher said to his students, anyone who chooses to follow Christ must also be a sign. And this is what we affirm when we do the sign of the cross. We sign ourselves with the sign of the cross. We start from our forehead to our chest. What does that mean? That's a capital I. That we cross ourselves. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. I no longer live for the world, but the one who died on the cross. I'm no longer led by the flesh, but by the Spirit, the one who dies for me. A sign of contradiction. St. Paul was a sign of contradiction. He chose to proclaim nothing but the one crucified, the truth of the gospel. He was ready to die for Christ. And he says in the reading today, I served the Lord with all humility, with tears, and with trials that come to me. Humility because he knows that goes contrary to the way of the world. And that is the weapon we would use to overcome the world. Tears, because he sees himself as blessed, as privileged to suffer offense for the sake of the gospel. When a faithful soul shed tears, they are always tears of joy. Because you know that Jesus He chose to live for Christ and not for the world. So he founded a community where people gathered to pray and to learn to practice works of mercy. He spoke frequently about humility, about joy. And he says that joy springs from a humble heart, but excessive sadness, excessive anger spring from a prideful heart. Philip didn't just preach about humility, about joy. He lived a humble life and was always filled with joy. There was a story about him praying on the Pentecost Eve in the chapel, and suddenly a ball of fire appeared and entered into his mouth, and he could feel it expanding inside him, filling him with incredible joy, and he couldn't contain that joy. He was rolling himself on the floor, exclaiming, "Lord, enough! Enough, Lord! I can bear it no more." No one can contain the joy of the Lord. It's overflowing. We are in this week of Pentecost, and I encourage you to find time to pray in silence. I don't mean communal prayer or praying with your family, but set time aside each day to be alone with the alone God and listen to the Spirit. And examine yourself and see if the way you live your life, the choices you make, conform to the standard of the world. If it does, ask yourself, am I living for the world or for the Lord? Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruits of the earth, the work of human hands, it well will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruits of the vine, the work of your hands, it well will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God.
In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out. Church and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance. brothers and sisters, behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Let's pray.